Thank you, Professor Chattopadhyay, for the introduction. And it's an honor to be here. And I'd like to first of all thank Professor Lohia to have thought of me and placed me amongst such illustrious speakers. And that too, within a, primarily a discourse of, on science, to call somebody like me to talk about yoga and dance. So it's really, it's a privilege and an honor, and I would say it's a very interesting mix, and a very important one, actually, coming from my point, from dance's point of view. I am here to talk about a complexity, but from another perspective of dance and yoga. And I think the popular opinion about dance and yoga is that these are minor preoccupations, and these are peripheral. These are peripheral to society. It's kind of a luxury that somebody opts to do dance or yoga or something, but they really don't really have an influence upon who we really are. But I strongly feel today that our Indian identity is very strongly determined by the complex histories of these two embodied practices of dance and yoga, which have and it's a very very complicated history and not a very clean history. And I'd like to talk a little bit about that today. I'm talking from a position where I think that dance today, especially dance, and yoga is fast becoming one, is in crisis. And the crisis is because a cultural practice has become a mode of cultural exhibition. And once you begin to exhibit a practice, things become complicated. And dance has been our main source of cultural exhibitionism. And exhibitionism does not come without chauvinism. And chauvinism, when it reflects back upon ourselves, might be revelatory of other things. Similarly, yoga is also becoming something that we are beginning to flaunt and become exhibitionistic about. And so yoga too is in peril, as dance has been for a very long time. In my title, I talk about delicate narratives, the delicacy, the volatility of this very delicate narrative of yoga and dance. The narrative itself is not delicate, but it's actually quite volatile. And the narrative, if I say that what the narrative is, that dance particularly tries to express, essentially the narrative is that we are a moral people, we are a spiritual people, we are a mysterious people, and yet the mysteries that we kind of express through our rituals and our symbols can be profoundly explained. So this thing of explaining that this is mysterious and yet it is somewhere scientific. So I'm glad that we are within a science symposium. That though we are very mysterious and very charming, everything that we do has actual lofty meaning, which only the wise shall see, and we shall deliver that to you somehow. And this is this actually translates into a stance. So a dancer has to assume a stance, go on stage, and there's a bit of edification. And when we, I'm a student of Kalakshetra, and the thing that gets drilled into you is that you are there to edify. The dancer goes and educates. And the minute you kind of come, that means you're on a pulpit. A dancer is on a pulpit and delivering. So there's a kind of a sense of largesse. I'm going to come and deliver wisdom to you, and you know. So this is a problematic assumption, first of all, a very, very problematic one. And I'd like to kind of go into the history of it as to how we came upon this, and how assuming this dance is actually very anti, it's the antithesis of art making. You cannot be self-conscious and chauvinistic and yet be making art or being creative or forging into new territories. It is mutually exclusive. So in case we do want to kind of forge into new territories of making art, which is meaningful, we have to drop this stance. And we cannot today drop this stance without brutally examining it. And by examining these dances, we might have to examine the very people who have brought us to this place. Like, I am a product of Kalakshetra, and I'm a product of the Krishnamacharya Yoga Mandiram. And both Krishnamacharya sir and Rukmini Devi are the two people who have brought yoga and dance into the modern world. And yet, I adore them, I love them, I respect them. I would not be here if they were not there. And yet, I feel that the premise that they occupied in those times needs to be critiqued today. Unless we don't critique that premise, we really don't have a go. Because that, the stance that was manufactured then was a stance in reaction, in defense. It was maybe a very feeble but a very surreptitious talking to the empire. But I am not talking to the empire anymore. I mean, my sense of identity is beyond my reacting or my explaining or my defending to an empire which has an agenda of shaping me. So iske liye bahut, so what I'm trying to get to is that it's a historical moment in the 19th century, and of course it extends to the 20th century, and of course it comes on all the way now, where we historically as Indians make a shift in premise. And this premise is from shifting to the idea of India, as opposed to the lived histories of India. And I think this shift in premise primarily takes place upon the embodied practitioner, the yogi and the devadasi. Now, this is where I say that these things are, that the yogi and the devadasi are not peripheral, dance and yoga are not peripheral. Had we not tamed the wild, warrior, ascetic, militant yogi, and had we not moralized the devadasi, India would not be ready to step into the modern world. We would never be modern, because these two entities, which were so closely attached to us, they were integral to us, would not allow us an entry into a modern world, which is categorical. So these people are sacred and profane, and to come into a modern world, we have to be either sacred or profane. We can't be two. And it's like, it's a kind of a mutual exclusivity about these. So I just want to kind of trace the history to some, make it as brief as possible. Let's begin with yoga, because the construction of the yoga narrative happens first, about 50 years prior to Bharatanatyam. And it is let's go back to this late 1700s when the Orientalists are discovering the Yoga Sutras right here in the Asiatic Society Library. They're finding the texts. They're finding our texts to rule us better. The whole idea of finding our texts is to how to rule the native better, and also how to evangelize. So Yoga Sutras are found, and the Bhagavad Gita is found. Warren Hastings right here commissions the first translation of the Bhagavad Gita. And he also says that he kind of really is fascinated by the idea of yoga and meditative practices within the Bhagavad Gita, and he actually writes that in the foreword of the first translation. But at the same time, within a couple of years, or within a decade or so, he's also banishing the fakirs and the sannyasis, because the sannyasi rebellion is also happening. And he's calling them miscreants, he's calling them vagrants, he's calling them all kinds of names, and they're banished. So he's kind of trying to, at one time, he's valorizing the idealized practices, and also the definition of yoga, which has become popular today, which is union with God, which is singularly the Bhagavad Gita definition of yoga, and not the definition of yoga from other texts or other schools of thought. So he's aiding that, and at the same time he's suppressing the practitioners. About almost like a century later, Swami Vivekananda, who of course is the alumni of this illustrious institute, he creates this text called the Raja Yoga. Now the Raja Yoga is a very interesting text, because it kind of valorizes, it is Yoga Sutras, so to speak, Patanjali's Yoga Sutras, but with an interesting mix of Hatha Yoga as well. Now, I'll make this very short here, but it's a very, very long history, where, actually I should read out
a little quote from Swami Vivekananda.
So Swami Vivekananda is in England. He's on his way to America. And he is trying to find ways of how to make the spirituality of India available to the world. And he's in correspondence with one of his collaborators, Mr. E.T. Sturdy, and he says he has two visitors who come to him from England, and they come to him and they say, and he says, both of them wanted to know the rituals of my creed. This opened my eyes. It is absolutely necessary to form some ritual and have a church. That is to say, we must fix on some ritual as fast as we can. We shall go to the Asiatic Society Library, or you can procure for me a book which is called Hemadri Kosh, from which we can get what we want. And kindly bring the Upanishads. We will fix something grand from birth to death of a man. A mere loose system of philosophy gets no hold of mankind. This is from his collected works, number 8, pages 356. So this whole thing of crafting a practice which can be doled out, which can be given out, is really quite the focus of how to craft something, because something has to be offered. A mantra, a practice, a ritual, something tangible which a practitioner can just go and imbibe and re-practice. And so then, of course, we know that he goes to Chicago and there's the Chicago conference. And then comes the Raja Yoga. He writes the Raja Yoga. And Raja Yoga, he's in New York, and he asks his agent to send him a copy of the Yoga Sutras, which he has heard about. And that's when he reads the Yoga Sutras and he creates Raja Yoga. Now the thing is that while he's doing this, he's at the same time vehemently rejecting Hatha Yoga. Now this is very, very important. He is banalizing Patanjali's Yoga Sutras and he is vehemently rejecting Hatha Yoga. Why? On what grounds does he reject Hatha Yoga? Because Hatha Yogis, according to him, are mystery mongers. They are mischievous. They are giving us, so to speak, we are uncomfortable with them. They're giving us a bad name. And he says categorically, any practices that he doesn't name the Hatha Yogis right there, that these people advocate, should be immediately rejected, because mystery mongering weakens the brain. So this is a quote from Swami Vivekananda. So this whole thing of valorizing the idea, at the same time rejecting the practitioner, this is a huge shift of going to the text, and at the same time totally obliterating a lived history, a lived tradition of centuries old experimentation with the body. So the Hatha Yogi is, first of all, Warren Hastings has already kind of made a law, so to speak, that not more than 5 Hatha Yogis could be seen together. This is like in the 1700s. And here he is declaring that yoga is our gift to the world, and it is Patanjali Yoga. And Patanjali Yoga Sutras, by the way, are just rediscovered about 80 years prior to this. Similarly, it's also interesting that in the 1930s, Dayanand Saraswati, who's also experimenting and he's also kind of really inquiring deeply into these practices, he's trying to understand Tantra. He's understand the yogic body, so to speak, which is in which we have chakras and nadis and vayus and all that stuff. And he's very, very curious and inquisitive, and he pulls out, he really wants to know whether these chakras are real or not, whether they are scientific or not, or whether they're just ideas. And he actually pulls out a corpse floating in a river, dissects it to see if there are chakras inside it, and he doesn't find them, so he chucks the corpse and the books of Tantra along with it, saying that I've had enough, this is not scientifically proven, so I shall do this practice of yoga, so to speak. So this whole move to rationality, to science, to something that is tangible, that is happening through the 19th century, and Swami Vivekananda, of course, you know, he caps it. And he gives us a little Bible, actually, the Raja Yoga, of yoga, which is a very interesting mix of Patanjali Yoga's Yoga Sutras with Hatha Yoga in it. He says you must do asanas, but don't get too obsessed with them. But when he's talking about asanas, you also have to realize that he's also getting influenced by what is a very strong movement happening in Britain at that time, and the movement is a muscularizing, a muscular Christianity, where during the Victorian era, there's a whole movement of reforming the physical fitness in schools, so that because the idea is that a strong body is a moral body, a strong body has moral will, and thus is a spiritual body. So this whole thing of physique and strength equals morality is also becoming very prevalent. And he also endorses that, and he also wants that. But at the same time, he's cautioning. He says, do the exercises, but also be careful. But then he's also putting a lot of pranayama in it, but he's also talking a lot about kundalini, which is categorically a tantric phenomena. It is not a Vedantic phenomena. Kundalini is a... So he's talking about Patanjali Sutras. Now, I just need to let you know that Patanjali Sutras are written about 2,000 years ago. And in Patanjali Sutras, there are only 1.5 sutras that talk about asana. It's got... there's nothing but the body, so to speak, in it. It is, of course, based on the body. But there are no asanas, there are no techniques, there are no... pranayama. It mentions pranayama, it advocates pranayama, but it doesn't give any techniques. All these techniques that we are performing today, asanas, pranayama, nyasa, mudra, all these are tantra and hatha yoga. So Vivekananda gives us a combination of that. Let's skip a few decades later, come to dance. So just as Vivekananda makes a sweeping statement of saying, reject the hatha yogis because they're mystery mongers, Annie Besant in 1916 declares that the Devadasis were supposed to be like Catholic nuns, and now that they have lost their chastity, they have no business being the ritual agents that they're supposed to be. But you also have to realize that she makes the statement at a time when the Theosophical Society is under a cloud of sexual scandal. So to talk of morality, to talk of chastity, becomes very, very important. And so she makes this declaration. Again, the whole reconstruction of dance that we are dancing today, I would say, is based on this one statement that the Devadasis were supposed to be chaste, like Catholic nuns, and they are not, so they must go, and we must come step in. So that is why I'm here, actually, as a Bharatanatyam dancer, on this statement. Had that statement not been made, had that statement not been taken seriously, people like me might not have been able to enter. So it's kind of a mixed thing that we're talking about here. 10 years later, Rukmini Devi, her protege, starts Kalakshetra, and this is her attempt to save the baby from the bathwater, to let the Devadasis go, but retain the dance. And align the dance to the Natyashastra. So this very important thing to realize is that this is the 19th century, earlier 20th century. The Protestant idea of going back to the text is ruling, so to speak. So everybody's going back to the texts. Dhyanananda Saraswati goes back to the Vedas. Vivekananda goes back to the Yoga Sutras. Rukmini Devi is going back to the Natyashastra. And in between, they're obliterating and actually annihilating the lived practices. This is very important to register, like emotionally register, that lived histories are obliterated to create an Indian idea of what it should be, what we should be doing. So to come to dance, this thing of aligning the Devadasi dance to Natyashastra actually spawns an aesthetic. And what's the aesthetic? It's the aesthetic that I have kind of totally internalized. It's the aesthetic of restraint, that bilkul sankoch ke saath kaam karna hai, number one. And number two, it's an aesthetic of feigned innocence. That you're always like a forlorn, innocent Nayaka. Who's gonna, you know, who's hapless, helpless, blemishless, and she's the victim, so to speak. So this aesthetic of restraint and feigned innocence is something that Indian dance is today. It's quite a stamp on Indian dance. And I'll tell you how this aesthetics of restraint is developed. There are two things I'll just talk about. There are many things. A is the hold of the elbows. So the elbow has to be up all the time. You cannot sag the elbow. It's like, you know, bad table manners that you can't put your elbows on the table. It's quite exactly that. It's that you have to keep the elbows up. Everything is like upar upar se. The elbow niche nahi aayegi. So this is a aesthetic which has been developed by Kalakshetra, and it is like all across Bharatanatyam today. And the second is biting the lip. In the Devadasi tradition, there are times when the dancer bites the lip. And it's not just a question of, you know, of being lewd, but it's also a question of when you feel something extremely, there's a bit of an acute sensation of biting the lip. So these two things are eliminated, that the dancers in Kalakshetra and from there on shall not bite the lips, because it's obscene to bite lips. Or to even show teeth. We've not been allowed to show teeth while smiling. So it was like a smitam, a big smile, not look too happy. At the same time, keep everything very formal and technical, and as though it's uninvolved, it's unengaged with the body. So there is this thing of the aesthetic blocking an engagement with the body. And my biggest grouse today is with both these engagements of dance and yoga is that the body is not engaged with. Of course, we beat the body into shape, we beat the body into form, but that's not the same as engagement with the body, as letting the body tell you ki usko kya man kar raha hai andar se karne ke liye. So the body is a very intelligent and a very sensitive organism. It will tell you what it desires as long as you are allowing it to speak. Before I take this forward, what I want to really say is that today the very ironic thing that's happened to India today is, especially to the embodied practices of dance and yoga, that both dance and yoga have come under the umbrella of Vedanta. And Vedanta is body dismissive. So placing an embodied practice of dance and yoga under the umbrella of a body dismissive doctrine doesn't really allow the body a chance. And that's where we are, that's the arrest that we are in. If dance and yoga are in crisis, which I can declare, and I'm sure Sadhanan is sitting here, he'll also agree, but we are in crisis. This is one of the reasons that the idea of Vedanta, which is controlling, which is body dismissive, has been placed upon the body, and the body is not allowed to, so to speak, flourish underneath this, because there is a conflict of interest. And before I end, I just want to kind of draw a genealogy of this Vedantic ambition to overrule the body. I just kind of mention very quickly that if you just trace the darshanas of India, the philosophies of India, in the 14th century, there is a doxography which is kind of which lists 16 Indian philosophies. So doxography is like an anthology or a listing of all the prevalent schools of thought that are active at a particular time. So the 14th century, there are 16 schools of thought, and it is a doxography made from the Sringeri Math actually. So it's a Vedantic perspective on these different schools, where Vedanta is considered to be highest and most superior, and the others are listed. So it begins with Charvakas who outrightly reject God, and it goes all the way to Vedanta, which is the finest, because it's from their perspective. And yoga is very close to Vedanta. So yoga is 15 and Vedanta is 16. A few centuries later, we end up with the Shtadarshanas, the six darshanas, which are only Sankhya, Nyaya, Visheshika, Sankhya, Mimamsa, Nyaya, Visheshika, Yoga, Vedanta. And today I ask, how many sitting here know what Sankhya is, what Mimamsa is, what Nyaya is, what Visheshika is, what Yoga as Patanjali Yoga Sutras is, and what Vedanta is. How many names do we know from here? So there is this thing of the plurality, which is abound in India, slowly begins to gets narrowed down. And today, we basically consider Vedanta to be the only Indian philosophy. And everything is kind of kept in reference or seen in reference to Vedanta. Vedanta is just one. And ye bhi nahi pata ki Vedanta bhi jo hai, 8 prakar ke Vedanta hai. It's not just Dvait and Advait. There are many other Vedants. And there are, within Vedants, there are many, there's a lot of discourse and discord between them. So before I come to an end,
am I already there?
Okay. I also want to say that this whole thing of making yoga Vedantic, अब सब वेदांता स्कूल में योगा सिखाया जाता है, कहा जाता है कि योगा वेदांतिक है, but categorically Shankara, categorically he rejects both yoga and Sankhya, and he actually even dismisses Kapila. So in the Vedanta Sutras, Vedanta Shankara rejects yoga, and आज वही योगा वेदांत के अंदर रखा गया है. So there are these internal conflicts which are glossed over, not examined, and so this whole thing of making yoga as a practice of union with God, I began with that, is a Vedantic idea. Whereas in Patanjali Yoga Sutras, there is, first of all, no mention of God. There is mention of Ishvara, and even Ishvara is made optional. It says, Ishvara pranidhanat va. Va meaning or, that either you believe in Ishvara or you don't. So Patanjali categorically gives you the option of not even believing in Ishvara, and Ishvara is not God. So when you, and in fact he even defines what Ishvara is, and Ishvara is not the creator, Ishvara is not the cause, and Ishvara is not the moral judge, which in orthodox religions is the definition of God, that God is the creator, God is the cause, and God is a moral judge. So ye kehna ki Patanjali Yoga Sutras is actually Vedantic, is really an it's historically and philosophically and unsound. Aur aaj hume yahi keh ke sikhaya jata hai. And again the same thing in dance, that dance is atma parmatma ki yukti. These are ideas, these are very fake ideas which produce fake dance. So one of the reasons that dance is in crisis is that we are seeing fake plastic veneer dance, and it's becoming more and more unbearable to watch, because uska jo itna halka ho chuka hai wo uski, because the idea has become thin now, and at the same time the body is not allowed to exceed the idea, and yet the body has the potential to exceed the idea. And this is the beauty of this body, that it is powerful, it is vital, and yet its wings can be cut, or at least in training they are. So I'd like to just kind of say that we are in a very strange mix of many falsifications, actually, when we have come today. So we are in a place where we are made to believe, and we are made to conform, and conforming is valorized. कि जो conform करता है वो बहुत अच्छा है. And the body has its own intelligence, and the body doesn't necessarily have to conform, but the body is also not what it is made out to be. Which is, the body is generally made out to be morally responsible. कि अगर आप अपने शरीर का को ज़्यादा ध्यान दोगे, तो आप बिगड़ जाओगे. You know, this is the idea that even matter is considered to be, or is viewed to be morally responsible. It is unpredictable. It is slippery. It will get you somewhere where you don't want to go. But at the same time, the body is super intelligent. The body is super sensitive. In fact, sensitivity is, according to Sankhya, sensitivity is spirituality. Aur Sankhya mein koi bhagwan nahi hai. अगर आप सांख्या पढ़ते हैं तो सांख्या में कोई भगवान का नाम नहीं है. There is no God in Sankhya. In fact, there are three texts of Sankhya, three major texts. The first two texts are completely silent on God. They're indifferent. The third text, which is the 14th century text, the Sankhya Prabhachana Sutras, it categorically says ki bhaiya, because we can't prove God, Pramana ke saath, we don't engage with it. So it's not rejecting it, it's not accepting it, but it's not engaging with it. And yet it is engaging with spirituality. So it is spirituality without an idea of a imposing, controlling, moralizing God. There's incredible freedom in that. And what it does is it just deals with materiality. It's the freedom that the sensitivity of materiality will bring out, as opposed to a conforming of a moralizing idea from top, which will contain, arrest, police the body. So dance, I just end with dance. Dance, jo hai, ye, so this whole narrative of dance that we are pure, we are moral, we are spiritual, we are here to adore. You know, this whole thing ki hum to sab ka kalyan karne ke liye aaye hain. Dancers ko dekho, sab kalyan kar rahe hote hain. But nobody talks about the annihilation, the cruelty, the meanness. Actually, it's not even cruelty, it's meanness. It's a petty history of annihilating a whole tradition of lived histories of Devadasis, of centuries and centuries of experimenting with the body, centuries of experimenting with the voice, centuries of experimenting with the breath. All those are obliterated, and an idea of the Natya Shastra is imposed upon it. But it's like, it's a history that dancers do not wish to talk about. And they don't want to address. But on the other hand, it is something that is inescapable. If dance today needs to proceed forward, I think it really needs to address this. And I just end with this, ki ye jo ek conflict hai na at the heart of dance and yoga, which is a falsification, which is a blatant, mean, petty, falsification, isko deflect kiya jata hai, isko gloss kiya jata hai, and dance kind of deflects it continuously by reinventing polarities. There's always some battle going on in dance, which deflects the actual mudda. The first battle was in the 30s, is the Devadasa supposed to be chased or not? Then the next battle came up, whether it is Shingharvas or whether it is Shinghara Bhakti. So these are these huge battles that are reinvented. The third was whether it's modern or contemporary, modernity or tradition. So dancers are always having to fight and take a stance. I'm for modernity, I'm for tradition, I'm for chastity, I'm for whatever. So, but aaj ye ho gaya hai ki now the dance is aaj aage jaane ki zarurat nahi hai. Now it's nationalism. It is to conform to this idea as nationalistic, and to challenge this idea is unnationalistic. So this polarity will not, as long as we are engaging with these polarities, which dance and dance is very prolific in this, keeps reinventing, we will not find that breathing space to stand in the center and just examine ki mera chakra kya hai aur meri body jo hai usme shamta kya hai aur main kya karna chahta hu ya karni chahti hu, as opposed to take a stance. So I think that if we really want to be free 60 years after our independence, we need to go back to the body, because iske andar kuch asli cheez isme sakt hai. And उस सत को प्राप्त करना, उसके साथ engage करना, is a matter of visceral practice. And it's not just question मेहनत की, मेहनत करो. Work is worship is a 19th century idea of productivity. We are not saying work is worship. Work is not worship. Leisure can also be worship. Sensuality can also be worship. Sukh can also be worship. But to lie in the body. Without and critique the ideas that are policing the body, because ye jo polarizations hain, ye polarizations jo hain, ye apne it's also a self policing generative process. Everybody, like, as a dancer, I feel that there's always somebody policing me. There's some akka, there's some didi, there's somebody who's always saying, no, you gotta pay. So there's this policing happening all the time, which doesn't give you the space. So I can just again say to end that as a practitioner of yoga and dance, we absolutely, first of all, we must begin to delve into history. In a very realistic history, you know, the history, I don't know how many historians are sitting here, but history has a very big conflict, whether history is archives or memory. And I think when we're talking of dance history, it's actually, it goes into beyond archives and memory, because there's no archive here. It's a fake archive. Memories we have obliterated. So it is the third idea, the idea. So it's archive, memory, idea. And this idea is just a veneer thin idea, which was crafted in defense. You can say it was a call to the nation, of course, but also a talking back to the empire. But the talking back to the empire was a very surreptitious seduction of a certain type of people who would get seduced. So Vivekananda doesn't speak to America. He speaks to a very, very, so to speak, people would say feeble-minded people, who are kind of mushy and who are like new age. Yeah? So, and we have made that into our creed. That new age esotericism, and of course theosophy plays a large part, because I'm from the Kalakshetra, theosophy plays a lot. So this whole thing of new age mysterious mumbo jumbo that has invaded dance and yoga is actually stifling and sucking the sap out of the beauty of these forms, which are embodied and powerful and beautiful. So, thank you.
I'm sure you're going to take a couple of questions.
Yeah, yeah, sure, sure.
I don't want you or anybody to take my question in the wrong way. I don't mean it at all. I would resent it if somebody takes it in criticism, but I have to ask this because the separation of the sacred and the profane was obviously not there, as seen in the walls of the Banarak and Kadurah. So to what extent, in your opinion, the invading cultures, such as Judeo-Christian morality, perhaps, including Islam, played a part, other than just the reaction of indigenous Indians?
I don't know if I'll be able to answer the question fully, but it plays, and that's what gets us onto the defensive to begin with. I mean, if you just kind of, I mean, forget Islam, because Islam, the equation with Islam was a completely different equation. They were not colonizers. We didn't have that equation. The equation comes when the white people come, so to speak. And I'm sure many of you already have read this document or know of it. The first damning of our traditions is from by this French Abbé Dubois, who calls, I mean, he really kind of, in fact, that's what really kind of gets everybody kind of very uncomfortable. I mean, he talks with the Devadasis and he says, you know, there are strumpets who, who open the halls of infamy, I'm verbatim quoting, who open the halls of infamy as soon as their lascivious practices in the temples are done. So he is kind of, and then he ends with saying, a religion more degenerate than Hinduism does not exist in the world. So this is 17, and then we have to realize that the East India Company buys this document to induct the new recruits. So this is kind of, you know, this is being spread, so to speak, as common knowledge and common opinion, a common perspective. So definitely, it is this that leads us to make a decision. We can't mix the two. It begins with a missionary damning, which of course gets taken over by the others then.
So I'm a physics undergraduate student in this university. And in this talk, you said about the falsification of dance and yoga. So I just wanted to ask you about what do you think that there's a rise in the practice of yoga in America, but it is mostly a superficial idea of yoga that's been practiced by American people. And most of these people who practice yoga in America are not Indians, and they are practicing this superficial form of yoga, which does not delve into the deep complexities and everything. So what do you think about this kind of falsification or appropriation?
Well, there are two kinds of falsifications. First of all, whatever American does very seriously. So when they are, of course, you know, this whole thing of what it's called modern yoga, which is like postures. Yoga has been reduced to postures. And yoga has been reduced to postures not by the Americans, but by the Indians. So this is what happens. This is the construction of modern yoga. And I won't name people who have actually done this. And America takes it forward. But I can also say that the real deep study of yoga also comes from America. I teach in America and I teach in India. And the quality of Indian students that I get are so, I think Indians do more cosmetic yoga than Americans. Americans do, bolia?
What do you mean by the word cosmetic?
Cosmetic is like, mujhe patla hona hai, mera pet andar kar do. And this is a, aap power yoga karte hai, wo kya hota hai? Pata nahi, maine suna hai, kareena kukur karti hai. These are the calls I get. So these are, it's like, you know, Indian dance and Indian music became popular after Ravi Shankar became popular in the West. So we have to examine where we are and who we are and what our positions are, because we don't understand yoga at all. We don't understand the body. I think the American understands the body better than an Indian does. So agar aapne yoga ke baat karni hai, toh, yes, they are kind of, you know, make this into a big industry. Yoga is a huge industry, and Indians would like to get a piece of that pie, and now they're trying to do it, and not in very dignified ways. So I don't think ki hum ye keh sakte hain ki wo bura kar rahe hain, hum bura kar rahe hain. We are on the same thing, and we started it.